Hi everyone, today we're going to be going over the early Paleozoic oxygenation history. To recap the last video we did over oxidation events, we talked about the NOE or the Neoproterozoic oxidation event. During this event, oxygen rose significantly in the atmosphere and the ocean. And the evidence that we have to support the timing and extent of this Neoproterozoic oxidation event lies in a record of redox sensitive trace elements and carbon and sulfur content in black shales, which suggest a late Neoproterozoic rise in atmospheric oxygen, but delayed ocean oxygenation until the Paleozoic. And as we'll see in this video, it gets a little controversial in terms of which period the ocean actually became fully oxygenated to modern levels. We also went over the causes of the NOE, which included increased continental weathering that caused enhanced nutrient supply and carbon burial, which caused an oxygen source to the atmosphere. This was caused not only by supercontinent breakup and reassembly, but also the greening of the land surface, which is something we'll focus a lot on today because during the Paleozoic, there were major advances in the evolution of land plants. And the last cause we talked about for the NOE in the last video was sponges being an ecosystem engineering species. And we'll talk a little bit more about some sponges during the Paleozoic, as well as some other major animals that had evolved during the Paleozoic and the role they played in the Paleozoic oxygenation history. The last part of the recap of our NOE video is the biological ramifications. We talked about what biologically and evolutionarily the NOE caused, and this included a major biodiversification of life on Earth, as well as the evolution of large complex oxygen-breathing animals. And this is what kicks our discussion off today, because this evolution of oxygen-breathing animals led to even more fluctuations in oxygen in the Paleozoic. This can be seen in this graph down here to the bottom left, where we have post-Neoproterozoic oxidation event showing all of these fluctuations in Earth's oxygen. For example, one of the things that oxygen-breathing life caused was the Ordovician mass extinctions because of this huge dip in oxygen after the NOE that was likely kicked off by oxygen-breathing life. So to take a closer look at the drop in oxygen that likely led to the drop in biodiversification of the late Ordovician mass extinctions, we can take a look at this graph showing the oxygen concentration in the atmosphere, showing this huge drop here compared to the biodiversity of the late Ordovician correlating up with that huge drop in oxygen, which also correlates with the major extinctions that occurred during this time. And we can see that drop in the second yellow arrow here on this graph we showed earlier after the NOE. But then we see an arrow going back up directly after this drop in oxygen and biodiversity of the late Ordovician. So does that mean that there was another oxidation event? Well, currently, most lines of evidence point to there being a Devonian oxygenation event. So this view has led to a new theory in which the NOE oxygenated Earth's atmosphere near completely to modern levels, and the ocean remained relatively anoxic and euxinic or sulfitic and anoxic throughout the Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, and throughout much of the Devonian until the mid to late Devonian, when there was a major rise in oxygen content. And we'll talk about this possible DOE or Devonian oxidation event throughout the next few slides in this video. First, we'll talk about some molybdenum evidence. Like we mentioned in the last video, we talked about how molybdenum is a redox sensitive trace metal, which is really helpful for understanding and tracking redox fluctuations throughout Earth's history, meaning reducing versus oxidizing conditions, which is largely controlled by oxygen content. So as we see in this graph, we have these blue and green bars here, each one associated with a jump in molybdenum values. These blue and green bars represent the emergence of large Ediacaran animals and the invasion of vascular Devonian land plants, respectively. To give a little context behind molybdenum and how to interpret its isotopic patterns, high molybdenum isotopic values are found in oxic oceans, whereas little to no fractionation occurs when molybdenum is removed under sulfitic or euxinic conditions. This suggests that sulfitic conditions were much more widespread in the Proterozoic and early Paleozoic oceans than today. And the isotopic trends that we see near these blue and green bars, or the Ediacaran and Devonian respectively, suggest that there were two major episodes of oxygenation in the ocean over the last 600 million years. The first episode, coinciding with the NOE event, or the Neoproterozoic oxidation event, during the the Ediacaran, which also coincides with the evolution of Ediacaran fauna, so multicellular macroscopic animals. And the second event lining up with the green bar, or the emergence of vascular land plants around 400 million years ago. And the fact that the ocean didn't become fully oxygenated until 400 million years ago suggests that the early metazoans, like sponges, for example, and other species that appeared during the Cambrian, Ordovician, and Silurian, evolved in a relatively low oxygen environment compared to that of today. And because of this realization, it's thought that the Inuit increased oceanic oxygen levels from about 10 to 15% of modern levels to about 15 to 50% of modern levels, rather than completely to 100% modern day levels of oxygen. And so this could be significant in studying those animals' functions and evolutionary history compared to that of animals that evolved post-Devonian oxygenation. AKA, I'm emphasizing here that more research is needed to understand this exact amount of oxygenation increase and what that means in terms of biological evolution, as well as what that can mean in terms of significance in today's environment, climate, and understanding the ecosystem as a whole on Earth today. But we are focusing on the DOE in this section of the video, so let's try and understand what might have caused this Devonian oxygenation event, or the second major episode shown here by the molybdenum evidence of redox fluctuations. What we know about this second oxygenation event, or this Devonian oxygenation event, or DOE, is that it correlates with two major events in Earth's history. And these include the major diversification of vascular land plants, which likely contributed majorly to the oxygenation of the planet by enhancing carbon burial, and the diversification of animals with high oxygen demand, such as large predatory fish. And we'll get to the fish later, but first we'll talk about the vascular plants and why they are so important. Well, vascular plants increased land erosion, global sedimentation rates, the hydrologic cycle by speeding up groundwater atmospheric exchange, and the burial of terrestrial organic matter. Additionally, the storage of a larger organic carbon pool because of this terrestrial organic carbon that wasn't really around before stabilized Earth's atmosphere at a state of higher oxygen content, forever changing the chemistry of Earth. And I think it's cool because it's analogous to the Great Oxidation event in that the cyanobacteria, which were the first photosynthesizers on Earth, changed the face of Earth forever as well. And both events were due to oxygen-releasing photosynthesizing organisms. And so it's just amazing what biology can do to Earth. But before we get to why these vascular plants really did enhance these five major processes that we list here, we need to talk a little bit about another line of evidence that we have for this Devonian oxidation event, because we can't just rely on molybdenum evidence. So here on this slide, we have some evidence from the only redox-sensitive rare earth element, which is cerium, which was measured in marine carbonates to track seawater oxygen levels. And the consistency found in this cerium anomaly, which is just what they're calling their cerium measurements in these sediments, is observed through time and through a global distribution of samples, suggesting that it records accurate global variations in oxygen levels. And it is also consistent not only with other cerium measurements in other sediments around the world, but also with molybdenum and other redox-sensitive element data. And like those other data, it indicates two major episodes of oceanic oxygenation through Earth's history, including, like we mentioned earlier, the Ediacaran and the Devonian oxygenation events. So focusing on the DOE, if we take a look at these graphs over here, we first look at this bottom one, which is just looking at cerium through time. We can see that during the Cryogenian period, which was around 800 million years ago, we have these purple dots of cerium values, and then we have the Ediacaran red dots of cerium values, then we have the Paleozoic green dots, and then you have the post-Devonian and modern dots in yellow and blue, respectively. And what we can see from this graph, basically, without getting into the nitty-gritty, is just that the correlation of pre-Devonian compared to that of post-Devonian and modern cerium values is incredibly distinct. We see this consistent trend toward modern values, and the post-Devonian values are very similar to that of modern values, in contrast to all the pre-Devonian values. Additionally, if we look at this graph in the middle here, showing the mean pre-Devonian cerium values compared to that of the mean of post-Devonian values, and now we can really see the distinction variation in pre-Devonian and post-Devonian cerium values. And since this cerium anomaly measurement is tracking oxygen throughout Earth's history, you know there must have been a very big difference between ocean oxygen before the Devonian compared to that of after or post-Devonian. So now to put this on a graph compared to that of oxygen through Earth's history, maybe we can see it a little bit better. Here we have cerium values through Earth's history shown in this major green curve on top of this diagram, and then we have this dashed line showing the oxygen through Earth's history. So to summarize the cerium through time, we have cerium values that indicate a moderate increase in oceanic oxygen during the Ediacaran. So cryogenian cerium values of 1.1 go down to around 0.62, followed by a decrease in oxygen levels during the early Cambrian, shown by an increase in cerium values of 0.62 to around 0.9. And we can see this drop around here on the graph. And this indicates that ocean anoxia was persisting through the early to mid Paleozoic until finally during the Devonian, we have the large increase in oxygen shown by cerium values of 0.8 going to those analogous to modern levels in the late Devonian of around 0.55. And we can see this increase right here lining up with the jump in cerium values as well as oxygen increase. And now if we take a look at the bottom part of this graph, I want you to focus on what correlates with the drop in oxygen during the early Cambrian and what correlates with the rise in oxygen during the Devonian. Well, we talked about at the end of the last video and beginning of this video, the evolution of animals likely caused a decrease in oxygen directly following the Neoproterozoic oxidation event. And then we just got through talking about molybdenum evidence lining up with the evolution of vascular plants. And this is in complete agreement with the timing of the Devonian oxygenation shown by the cerium values, which suggests that the vascular plants are key in this Devonian oxygenation event. So, likely when large vascular land plants and forests evolved, oceanic oxygen levels reached near modern levels, if not higher than modern levels. The exact increase is still uncertain. But what we do know is that these land plants, rather than animals, were responsible for the full oxygenation of the modern Earth system. And so now let's talk a little bit more about why this might be. So like in the last video, we discussed how the greening of the Neoproterozoic land surface and soil production was a major contributor to the oxygenation during the Neoproterozoic. However, soil production, which enhances weathering and causes a carbon sink and oxygen source, increasing oxygen on Earth, doesn't happen so readily in plants that had evolved by the time of the Neoproterozoic as it does in the types of plants that had evolved by the Devonian. The Devonian marked a transition from non-vascular plants like mosses to large vascular trees and forests, which began to majorly diversify in the Devonian. These larger and vascular plants produced more abundant and thicker soils because they had roots which could go down deeper into the ground and break up the bedrock and produce soil more rapidly and more deep into the Earth's surface, as well as more abundant and widespread throughout the continental land masses on Earth at the time. And this soil production led to major continental weathering as well as major photosynthetic processes occurring at the surface of Earth, leading to more atmospheric oxygenation as well as oceanic oxygenation through carbon burial. So what do we know now? Well, first we know that the oxygen rose during the NOE or the Neoproterozoic period, but likely only in the atmosphere and not so much in the ocean. And then we have it rise again in the Devonian, which lines up with vascular plant evolution, which likely caused the oxygenation of the ocean. And from then on, we have a stabilization of oxygen levels, at least to our knowledge at this point, at around modern levels from the post-Devonian to the recent or now. However, what's in between there? We briefly mentioned that the Cambrian marked a period of decreased oxygen or deoxygenation, and this was likely due in part to animal evolution. But what's our exact evidence for this other than the oxygenation events and animal evolution? What geochemically can we see in the rock record that points to this deoxygenation event? And how might we track this deoxygenation event differently than maybe the oxygenation events? So let's talk now a little bit about this deoxygenation event. So we can see here on this slide, we have the carbon isotope move trends shown here from the Cambrian to the Ordovician. And something we notice right away is this major spike in carbon isotope composition during the late Cambrian. So what is this? So it's labeled here SPICE, and SPICE just stands for the Steptonian Positive Carbon Isotope Excursion. And this is the largest positive carbon isotope excursion in Earth's history. And there's some controversy over what it necessarily indicates. Some think that the SPICE event oxygenated the oceans completely because a spike in positive carbon isotope ratios in inorganic carbon or carbonate minerals indicates a period of carbon burial, causing an oxygen source to the atmosphere and oceans. However, like we just talked about on the last few slides, a lot of other people think that it wasn't until the Devonian that the ocean became fully oxygenated. So what is the consensus here? Well, we kind of land on the consensus that the SPICE event rose oceanic oxygen levels, but then they fell again directly after that event, decreasing them below modern day levels once again, and then they remained relatively low throughout the Ordovician and Silurian, and then they finally rose back up during the Devonian, as shown by the molybdenum and cerium evidence we just talked about. And this is when it stuck, because during the Devonian, that oxygenation event was due to vascular land plant evolution, which caused the major proliferation of land plants and therefore terrestrial organic matter, increasing the pool of organic carbon on Earth as a whole, which changed Earth's organic carbon pool forever, and therefore changing Earth's chemistry forever and causing this more permanent oxygen rise during this major transformation of Earth's terrestrial realm. So we've been talking a lot about oxygen in the atmosphere as well as a little bit in the ocean, but we haven't really made much of a distinction between deep ocean and surface ocean. Throughout the next few slides, that's what we want to do. So on this figure, we can see the Cryogenian period around 800 to 635 million years ago, showing widespread anoxia or euxinia of the ocean during this time, mainly in the mid-depth to deep ocean realm. And then during the Ediacaran, there's isotopic evidence from redox-sensitive trace metals, such as molybdenum and uranium, that indicate frequent intervals of ocean oxygenation and deoxygenation, likely regulated by primary production and ocean circulation. And we can see this here in the Ediacaran block, shown by the blue to yellow to orange to blue to yellow to orange intervals in this time block. And finally, in the early Cambrian here, we had that decrease in oxygen in the Cambrian, like we saw on the slide with the cerium values, and that caused the early Cambrian ocean to remain much less oxygenated than today, especially in the mid to deep seawater realm. So what about after the Cambrian? Because this figure doesn't go past the Cambrian, we'll look at a new figure to go to the Ordovician and eventually the Devonian. So this figure shows late Cambrian to early Ordovician ocean conditions. And as we see, there's oxygen minimum zones, or OMZs, which surrounded ancient continents during this time and expanded into shallow shelf environments during periods of sea level rise. And these periods of sea level rise and oxygen minimum zones expanding to the shelf environment during these rises, such as shown here at the top of the slide, these red zones expanding upward in the shelf environment, caused a lot of early Paleozoic extinction events of animals that lived in this benthic realm. However, then as we move to the mid-Ordovician, we get upwelling and nutrient inflow from rivers, promoting more primary productivity in the shallow waters, causing these green ovals to come and form, and this increased atmospheric O2, but still left deep oceans pretty oxygen depleted due to that increase in primary productivity and stratification caused by the increase in respiration beneath those algal blooms. But then we finally move from the Ordovician to the Silurian and Devonian, where we can see oxygen levels increase as OMZs, or oxygen minimum zones, these red zones here, were pushed deeper and deeper in the water column, thus increasing oxygen content in the surface and mid-level oceans, and only having those anoxic or low oxygen zones in deep restricted parts of the oceans. So all of these things are telling us that during the Devonian is when the ocean likely became relatively fully oxygenated. And this caused some major advances in animal evolution. These advances include the evolution of animals with high oxygen oxygen demands, such as large predatory fish. And this is a reason why the Devonian period is often called the Age of Fish. And this is because large fish began evolving and diversifying and proliferating the ocean during this time. But this is not the only thing that early Paleozoic oxygen fluctuations caused in terms of biological evolution. Going back a little bit to the Cambrian and Ordovician, I know we're jumping around a lot here. This is, yes, before the Devonian, before the major oxygen rise, but I just want to show you here this figure which shows Cambrian to Ordovician oxygen level indicators associated with changes in biodiversity. To give a little background, microbial carbonates were major components of early Paleozoic reefs. Before the major corals and stromatophoroids and bryozoans that built up reefs later in the Ordovician and onward really appeared and started to dominate. So these microbial carbonate reefs during the Cambrian and early Ordovician were dominant, and they were often augmented by lithocid sponges, and these microbial carbonate lithocid sponge reefs dominated during the mid to late Cambrian as shown here. But if we look at the trend in biodiversity here in the pink line, we see a low period in biodiversity here during the time that these lithocid sponges dominated reef building. So why did they choose a period of decreased ocean oxygenation, increased greenhouse conditions, and decreased biodiversity to thrive? So some scientists really picked this apart, and basically they found that the mid to late Cambrian period was unusually warm in temperature, which lowered oxygen solubility, which caused widespread marine dysoxia and hypoxia, which just means really low oxygen conditions, causing a lot of the episodic Cambrian extinctions that are seen in this period. However, we know now that lithocid sponges have an ability to withstand low oxygen levels, and this is what differentiated them and allowed them to proliferate global reef environments in association with microbial carbonates during this time. Then by the Ordovician, temperatures declined again, once again increasing the biodiversity of reef-building ocean life, leading to what is called the Great Ordovician Biodiversification Event. So to recap biodiversification history along with oxygenation history from the Cambrian to Ordovician to Silurian, I'm going to re-show you this figure where we can see the Cambrian low oxygen and low biodiversity trends, then going to the Ordovician rise in oxygen as well as rise in biodiversity, and then moving to the late Ordovician drop in oxygen levels leading to the major drop in biodiversity in the late Ordovician causing the Ordovician extinctions. And it's not shown on this figure, but then we know that during Silurian things remained relatively steady, and then during the Devonian, directly after the Silurian, we had the major increase in diversification in vascular plants, which led to the major oxygen event in the Devonian, or the DOE as we nicknamed it in this video. That is it for early Paleozoic oxygen history. We'll probably have another video later down the road over mid to late Paleozoic oxygen in history, because we do have the Carboniferous period, which was named after major carbon burial events. So we'll talk about that in a later video. But basically, to recap, from Neoproterozoic to the Devonian, we had the GOE, or the Great Oxidation Event, caused by the evolution of cyanobacteria. Then we had the NLE, causing the evolution of large complex animal life. Then we had the yo-yo drop in oxygen due to this evolution of animal life. And then this caused the major Ordovician mass extinctions, but then O2 rose again once we got into the Devonian due to the evolution of vascular plants, and this caused the evolution of large predatory fish. And then we have this stabilized period in Earth's oxygen from the Devonian onward until today, or at least to our knowledge currently. But there's still a lot that we don't know. And this is not only pointed out here by this purple arrow after the Devonian, but also by this huge uncertain period of over a billion years of Earth's history. And one of the ways that we can look into constraining these oxygen levels during Earth's history is by redox-sensitive trace elements. And I've talked about many of these elements, such as molybdenum and vanadium and uranium and cerium in the past couple videos, but I am going to do an entire video on it. So if it's out by now, go check it out. If not, I hope you come back for that. And with that, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye. Actually, I can't remember what that is. Let me actually check what that is. Oh wait, for the but anyway, can we talk about that? You guys can see my to-do list. Whoops.